Welcome to a more art historical version of Art Loche. I know, false advertising. When I was at university, not too long ago by the way, I drafted an essay which tried to prove the fact that there is a new movement in art, or at least a pattern, involving art's commercialisation, as seen by the multi-million pound purchasing of artworks such as Murakami's My Lonesome Cowboy, which had a particular visual style. Rather than having artwork developed through academies and universities, we have art developing through private, high-finance galleries and auctions. And I term this movement chromism, coming from the word Chrome, not the Google browser. I've produced a link to this essay titled Chromism, Luxury in the Depth of Its Skin. Nice title. If you wish to read it, it's linked in the info section of this video, and it's there to be discussed and challenged. And please forgive me, I was quite young when drafting this. The pattern within chromism is high value art, where those aesthetic traits were developed in auction houses and commercial galleries of postmodern art that uses an immaculate high industrial finish, which is sometimes metallic or has an unreal gloss finish. Sometimes they also come in the form of highly airbrushed photos or a porcelain figure to appeal to our basic desire through its treasure-like presentation. This aesthetic begins probably with Jeff Koons, in particular the work Rabbit in 1986, as it has asked inscrutable questions about the link between aesthetics and market values. The critical nature of this aestheticism would be ebbed away, sadly, as some artworks would be rebranded or deified in its glory to match art's social climate. The movement ended or peaked or had a respite at the financial crisis of 2008, demonstrated by Jonathan Monk's Deflated Sculpture No. 1, 2009, where a hollow, inflated, shining rabbit built up by air is now collapsing. This is an obvious comment on Jeff Koons' rabbit, but also the art market itself. And at the same time, there was a failed sale of Hearst's For the Love of God, 2007, that had occurred. The picture of it should be popping up right now. On the point of For the Love of God having been bought back by Hearst with the White Cube Gallery and other investors to protect its price, as well as maintain its cultural value, a video will be made on this point specifically, shows the art world having to buy back or buy into its own mythology, i.e. putting their money where their mouth is. However, after 10 years, or nearly 10 years, in 2016, the markets have recovered, including the art market itself, to what was the pre-2008 crash profit levels. Chromism came about with the advent of the 1980s economic boom and its accepted materialism marked by Madonna's "We are living in a material world and I am a material girl." Due to the market's Darwinian nature, choosing through its principles of demand and supply, art, like any good, is mercilessly produced to give what we want today. Artists presently produce works of a type that please themselves and, in addition, pleasing the art market. With that logic, the way the auction houses and private galleries display works of art to be sold would show or give a general pattern of buying habits traceable by the aesthetics, or rather by the aesthetic nature of the art produced between the 80s and the noughties in the market. The highly reflective aspect of chromism has an unreal quality to it, giving art a further status in its glamorous presence. This new shine started and applied and maintained, may I state that, by artists such as Murakami, Hearst, Koons and Tusk to an extent, mimics a treasure-like quality due to the precious metal polish of the work. This expensive luster achieved by costly industrial methods is there to impress and taunt desires. The use of stainless steel, for example, reflected the years when people were earning money and spending extravagantly to extravagantly justifying the costly spectacular materials. As stated earlier, the surface of the rabbit represents the new high-end production of what is now possible in art. This type of finish was reserved exclusively for expensive cars and priceless skyscrapers like Mies van der Rohe's Seagram building. This type of aesthetic language is given to an artwork, or rather, with this type of aesthetic language given to an artwork, it becomes associated with a particular world in art. The Seagram building, with its bronze cast I-beams and amber windows that glisten with luxury in Manhattan, demonstrates this. Investing or purchasing in art which resembles such prized real estate or must-have cars would be logical, as the Hanging Heart or Hearst's Eternity, with their services, it is natural to assume that this would be sought after. This helps situate chromism into the art of the solely wealthy, safeguarded in the free market mechanisms of auction houses. Subsequently, this gives the art a new quality and depth of meaning. The function of corporations, or maybe individuals, give to art, establish its meaning, or that particular style may be interpreted in terms of organizational requirements, and this includes using aspects of artistic style to express status or match furniture. Compare the ephemeral performance art of the 1960s and 70s, like Morris's column 1962, that can be almost forgotten against the large, permanent, solid, heavy metal work such as The Rabbit, to their cellophane recordings, offering almost a material stability in comparison to the fading memory of film and personal memory itself. These chromistic works are designed to look, to be looked at, to be an ideal, something that has an aesthetic gravity alongside it, as well as a conceptual and market value to it as well. Also, what we see from Shirley Levine, when what she does to Duchamp's Rhino in 1991, is that by casting it in gleaming bronze, at last the wretched Urinal existed in real artistic materials, or rather real art materials. Levine coincidentally gentrifies Duchamp's urinal. Due to Levine, the urinal is now easier to understand as something special and precious. This also makes the work easier to own due to its commercial aesthetics of being idolized, and it is now a shining bronze cast of a urinal rather than a urinal itself. The confusion with the decorative commodity in art is apparent in wealthy collectors like Abby Rosen. It is a commodity like lots of other things. The difference is that you can live with that commodity. You can use it for socialization. It gives you a certain type of status and a certain type of place. Nonetheless, Abby Rosen has a point. It is the rabbit's outer physical attributes that allow us to see it as a commodity. The rabbit mocked the art world by playing it at its own game, and ridicules that art world when that image is purchased, or that work is purchased, charging them, or the collectors, millions of dollars for the pleasure of being laughed at. However, the joke is on the rabbit itself, or the artist, when the profit is made, or rather subsequent profits are made. What makes chromism is that the artistic merit has been created by external factors rather than intrinsic elements of an artwork, which all movements have over the centuries been touched by. These external factors are as follows: the significance of the artist, the contextual influence, i.e. where it has been seen, how it's found, the reader and viewer's response, and lastly, the role of the passionate few. The significance of the artist is almost now an artwork's brand. If the artwork carries a name, it carries a value as those with a name already established. Then that artwork will be received in a manner which differs greatly to that which a artwork by an unknown artist or author will be. The contextual influence, specifically where the artist was found, is seen how Hearst is shown in the Saatchi Gallery, and is constantly mentioned in Sotheby's or Christie's auction catalogues. This colours the reputation of the artwork to have a value and to be valued. This is because the practice of art in institutions, depending if it's an academy, university, or an auction house, changes the way in which the viewer perceives it, because this creates a whole series of learned assumptions about art, which is not only taste, form, or genius, but in our case, value. The reader slash viewer's response is the value given in an auction or the price paid by the buyer. And as the artwork becomes a luxury item, a desire for it or by those who see it to enforce a subjective want is continued with each sale. In addition, critics help perpetuate this point. The passionate few are the people who decide which works are worthy of our attention and at the same time help uphold the value of that work or those type of artworks. This group of individuals or people in this circumstances are private galleries, auction houses, and rich individuals who have marked works by Koons and Murakami or Hirst as premier work. This has a knock-on effect. This has a knock-on effect of, if I may quote this, most contemporary works are produced by artists who then seek to gain the attention and approval of influential figures in the art world, whose response to the work will govern its short-term future. This is evidenced when such works are put in auctions and private galleries where the work must meet or exceed reservations or pricing. This in turn would meet the aesthetics of the time, also meet the notoriety of chromoistic works or chromoism in this regard. Why is this art so valuable? Well, apart from being developed by the passionate few, it offers a form of art which we can understand via some sort of comprehensible parameters that we can appreciate, which has been absent in conceptual art or in art in the 20th century and the 21st century. This parameter is what is good art, and this is seen by the high finish of it, as well as the value attached to that artwork. This is because they are simple concepts to grasp. Traditional artwork, with its great craftsmanship, is easily understood as good because of the level of difficulty to execute it. Yet the narrative or its intellectual appreciation is often overlooked. Chromoism seems to answer that good art is high-valued art, which is expressed at every bid in each auction and hung in many auction spaces, or rather in many gallery spaces. Chromoistic art is there to be shown off and most importantly bought and sold, so to keep up its importance and value. This form of reassurance is maintained by being in auctions with some intermittence in its public viewing to be placed in opulent residences of its owners or in freeports. These are well-known physical tax havens for artworks. They're sometimes placed in Luxembourg or Singapore, just to name a few. Until the day the artwork is bequeathed to the nation to solidify its value for all time as a valuable form of culture. This enables its prior owners or investors to have validations for their taste, their monetary value, and giving them prestige. The repercussions for conceptual art is that it has now become solidified or commodified in its purest sense, as art is an object is to be owned and held by one buyer. And this is a return to a traditional physical monopoly as well as a cultural monopoly of art by the elite in society that is reminiscent of the Medicis, the Rothschilds, and the Courtaulds. Anyway, thank you very much. Hopefully we'll put in a new video soon, and thank you for watching. Please share and send us a comment on Twitter. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.